I think I'm going to kick us off because I know we have an hour, which always goes by so fast. So welcome everyone to one of our last Lunch and Learns of the year, which is, it's crazy to even think about. So thank you everyone for joining. We have an amazing panel today to talk about a cookie-less world, which has been a hot topic over the last few months. I'm just going to do a quick housekeeping around some SF big events that are coming up, and then the panel's all yours, Kristen. So just a reminder, next week, October 27th, we're doing a happy hour at 5 p.m. around kind of real estate. It's some industry veterans that have moved over to that industry and talking about real estate, especially in the Bay Area. And then November 10th, we have our very last Lunch and Learn with Linquia, and it's around thriving through change with influencer marketing. So I think that's really going to be quite relevant right as we roll into the holidays. And then our last event of the year is our golf tournament, which we're very excited about. We have only three foursomes left. So if you are thinking about attending, definitely contact someone at SF Big and we can get you set up. We also have some sponsorships still available. And in about 2 weeks, we will be opening up to individuals to join as well. So keep a lookout for that that notification. And with that, I'm going to turn over what a cookie-less world looks like to Kristen and the panel.
All right. Thank you, Bessie. And thanks everybody for joining us for what is certainly a hot topic in the industry. I'm Kristen Sheevy. I lead media at Digitas for the West Coast and co-lead media nationally for North America. So pleased to be here and supporting SF Big. And we have two amazing panelists who I'm going to let introduce themselves. We have Charlie from MIQ and Beth from Northwestern Mutual. So go ahead, take it away.
Go ahead, Beth.
As Kristen said, I'm Beth Riley. I lead media partnerships and social at Northwestern Mutual. I'm a whopping 5 weeks into the job. So before that, I actually ran my own business. As part of that business, I was an embedded employee. I ran media at Sprint, which is where I met Charlie, actually. And then I also ran global media and social at Motorola Mobility. And prior to that, I was at Kraft and Mondelez for many years, most recently running global digital for Mondelez, but and a long illustrious career on the agency side prior to that.
Cool, and thanks, Beth. And I'm Charlie, I'm the Chief Revenue Officer at MIQ in the US. I came from an early exchange, right, media, Yahoo world, progressed into social at Adaptly, which is now owned by Accenture. And now obviously here at MIQ focusing on programmatic. I'm also a dad of two kids and they're awesome. So I would like to say that. And I know Beth is a proud parent as well. We're both in Chicago. So if that personalizes us a little bit, cool. And I did used to live in the Bay Area. So happy to talk about any haunts or Presidio golf courses as the session progresses if we run out of content.
Yeah, Charlie wants one of those foursomes, don't you, at the golf tournament?
I might drive out for the golf tournament.
Correct. We did a bit of a flip-flop. I'm originally from Chicago and moved out to the Bay Area 5 years ago. So I understand when golf goes away and the winter comes, it can be brutal.
It can indeed. I'm experiencing that now.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for being here, both of you. For all the panelists, or I'm sorry, for all the attendees, we thought that we would start with a quick little history lesson on what is a cookie? Why does it matter? Why is the industry up in arms about this whole issue? So we'll do a little bit of 101 before we dive into some specific questions. So in short, cookie is a piece of code, and I think the simplest way to describe it is it gives the internet a memory. So the sort of earliest forms of, you know, that everybody has experienced as a shopper, you place something in your cart, that website remembers what items you have in your cart. I remember at one time, I think Nordstrom and Zappos were the absolute kings and queens of retargeting on the internet, reminding you that you hadn't quite bought that pair of shoes and checked out. So all of those kinds of things are enabled by cookies, and it is a lot of the way that we are doing measurement in the industry. It's a lot of the way that we're doing targeting in the industry. It affects creative if you're doing dynamic creative. So the ways that we are using cookies for digital marketing is actually quite expansive. And so that's, you know, if you're thinking about the cookies going away and affecting your ability to be able to do measurement targeting and creative, it's a pretty scary thought for marketers that really depend on those things. So that's why we're here. That's a very brief background in short. And certainly, if you know, there's going to be people with a lot of diverse backgrounds in the crowd. So if you have questions, this is a complex topic. There are no stupid questions. So please utilize the chat. If you do have questions, you can submit throughout this session. I'll be checking in to see who's submitting, and we can get those questions answered. But since this is a complex topic and there's a lot of people in the mix, I thought I would start with the question of whose responsibility is this in the digital marketing ecosystem to take charge and to create a plan for what we're going to do about the end of third-party cookies?
I can start if that's okay, Charlie. Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, it's the responsibility doesn't lie with one person or group of persons, right? So from a brand perspective, I think, you know, we kind of need to take charge of our own destiny, right? You know, if you don't have it, you need to start building in-house first party data repositories that you can independently maintain. I think, you know, I work in an industry, again, 5 weeks in, but there's a lot of compliance and legal aspects to what we do. I think it is a cross-departmental charge. It's not just a media or a marketing charge. It is very much a compliance and legal charge as well. And I know, Kristen, when we talked on our chat the other day, I actually worked at Publicis for a time, for a year. And I remember clients would ask us, like, well, what do you think we should do? And you and I had talked about this, but like, you know, the agency can't really give advice. It's a client side. It's brand specific, right? You can give POVs, you can give information, but it's not really up to your agency. It is up to you as a brand marketer to kind of decide what your plan is. But I also think publishers bear a certain responsibility, right, to help us understand what alternate targeting and measurement solutions they're going to be developing to, you know, they're going to need to effectively monetize their platforms, right, moving forward. And if they can't provide me as a brand or an advertiser with a suitable solution, I may have to consider moving investments, you know, shifting them to other platforms that can. And then also some of these, the very companies taking away the cookie tracking, you know, I'm assuming they're also building new offerings to, you know, address user tracking and targeting on their sites. So it's a responsibility across the industry. But at speaking from a brand perspective, it's going to be across multiple departments internally and building a lot of the data that we need to do the targeting ourselves.
Yeah, and I think similar to what Beth said, I think we have a phrase around here that nothing here is someone else's problem. I think this is truly like an industry and even public problem, or, you know, a consideration we have to look at. So I think really the buckets of the people responsible are, you know, the first time there's an issue, you always have to look at yourself. Like, what do we as users and consumers have the ability to control and look at? Is that opting in to consent? Is that what our identity means? How targetable we are as users? How we vote on this issue is going to be, I think, probably one of the biggest political topics in the world in the next 10 years. So we as users and consumers, even outside of tech in our everyday lives, have the ability to control that, whether we opt into CRM on, you know, I bought some power tools today on Home Depot. Do I opt into CRM targeting? Do I opt into accepting cookies? Like, I'm voting every day for what I believe the future of tracking and privacy is. So as a consumer and as an individual, we have a responsibility. To Beth's point, big tech has a huge role to play. How Google thinks about this, how Facebook thinks about this, and how the people who design the plumbing of our ecosystem in the advertising world and the solutions that they roll out, they are hugely responsible for the future of this and what it looks like, as well as device manufacturers. Like, look at Apple's big new campaign around privacy. Like, they've taken stance. They're taking that responsibility seriously, and they will continue to do that. It's not going away. So big tech has a role to play. I think advertisers and agencies, they have a role to play because how you target users based on who they are is really the ethics behind this. It's not knowing who people are or what they do, but it's really the morals and the ethics behind targeting the people that you're able to identify. And I think agencies and advertisers have both done a phenomenal job of coming around on this really quickly and protecting their users and consumers. And I think, you know, we'll continue to see that evolution. And then really, I think the final two buckets that Beth mentioned, one that I really agree with, is publishers. It's like, publishers are going to have a monetary or fiscal crisis. Like, could their inventory be worth less because we don't have something like the cookie to track? And what is the price of ethics? What are the price of morals for those publishers? It's a really interesting question. And finally, I touched on it earlier. I also think legislators have a say in this. And I would like to remind everybody to go out and vote during the election. I don't know if that was discussed on the pre-panel conversation, but I think we all vote every day. Might as well get out and vote during the election and make your vote count, because I think we'll see this on more ballot initiatives and things coming up in the future. That's sort of high level, but I did want to say that.
It was not on our pre-panel discussion, but I would concur. I have actually already voted, but everyone should get out and vote. It's your civic duty. Yeah. I liked what you said, Charlie, about if you want to decide if you're going to be a part of a CRM program too, because I also think companies, brands are going to need to start reevaluating those offerings too. If they have a CRM program, if they don't, that's, you know, one of the ways they're going to start building their first party data. So like getting in there and determining where you're lacking across your marketing organization will be a big thing too.
Yeah, and I think some companies are doing really cool cookie-less things in that space already, like LiveRamp and their Identity Link rollout, and like the things that they're doing to protect users' anonymity and to resolve identity potentially without a cookie and in a compliant way that allows brands to track them at various points. That's like sort of one open web solution. Then you have sort of the closed web solutions of like Ads Data Hub and Google Compliance and things like that. But we can talk about that, I think, probably in some of the later questions. But yeah, I totally agree with you, Beth. This is mega.
You both have brought up already so many things that I feel like we could have an hour-long discussion on just one of those particular points that you made. But there's a couple of things in particular that I wanted to highlight. I think that Charlie, you brought up the issue of, you know, ethics. And I think that's a big one. A lot of what we're thinking about at Publicis is that this isn't necessarily a privacy issue as much as it's a consumer trust issue. That's the reason why all this is happening. And it's because, you know, maybe we've taken things a bit too far and now need to rein it in a little bit and be respectful of people's data, what we're doing with it, how it's being monetized, and giving people more transparency into what's being done with their data and how they're being tracked. And so I think ethics and trust is huge. And I agree that while, you know, we are in a space right now where regulators, are able and you know, looking to come in with antitrust, and we're voting on CCPA potentially addendums in California, but it's almost like we all as pieces of the industry also need to act and to take control and accountability. And Beth, I loved what you were saying as well, in that, you know, it really sort of starts with, you know, as a brand, like looking inward and trying to understand what it is that a brand needs to do, and then pulling in the different components in order to help you navigate, whether that be the publisher community, big tech, your agency partners, in order to kind of sort through it. But I do think a really big topic is, and it certainly is all projections at this point, but what the effects, so what the potential outcomes of this are going to be. And Beth, you mentioned shifting investments, you know, could be a really big outcome of this. You know, Charlie, you mentioned that publishers and how they're able to monetize and how that changes. There really are a lot of implications, I think, that are very broad reaching that need to be taken into effect as we all, from different points of the ecosystem, figure out how to approach. So if either of you have any other things to add on sort of like what are the expected you know, outcomes, happy to discuss that before we talk about preparation and what we're doing to get ready for this.
That was a really good point what you made about, like, you know, sort of the value versus the ethical dilemma. I think, like, there are times where it is valuable to do the unethical thing. Cheating on your taxes is unethical, but you can save money, or you can make more money. And that's a really big dilemma that, like, all of us face. Like, oh, maybe I won't declare this. Maybe I won't. It's like, everybody does it because it's the right thing to do, and because, like, it leads to a greater good. And there are going to be companies, and it's not going to be like a cut and dry solution where it's one day everything on the road is horses and people, and the next day it's all cars. It's like, there's going to be this time where there's going to be this waiting and this pushing and pulling of, like, how people use identity and how people use Pixel. And there are going to be ethical decisions that do value consumer trust. And I think as the consumer base changes and we all become more digital and we are all digital first and young people are more savvy with who they are online and their identity and things like that, that thing that you mentioned about consumer trust is so important, that I think it'll actually be like a brand pillar that will be something that brands want to discuss. It's like, not only do you want our product because it's good, but you want us because we treat you appropriately as a consumer of our products. It's not just about the product, but it's also about the brand's relationship with the consumer and the trade-off between willing to pay more to do that in a compliant way to speak to that consumer, or wanting to pay less and maybe not, you know, using the best methodology. That was a really interesting point, actually, about the consumer trust, Chris. And so,
yeah. I mean, outside of cookies, I think you see that happening anyway. You know, consumers are more apt to like a brand, buy a brand, follow a brand that they trust. So it is a really important point, you know, the trust aspect of it. And I think we've seen it a lot in the last, whatever, 7-8 months too. Brands that are building trust with consumers are more successful during this time.
Absolutely. Well, I would love to pivot to have each of you talk about, you know, what you're doing to prepare for the future, for the rollback of cookies, and what you see being done in the industry in order to prepare for what's ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I say, and I mentioned it earlier, but I mean, leveraging alternate data sources, right? So growing that first party data, which then we can use and, you know, modeling, suppression, re-engagement, you know, using data and information from connected devices within households, you know, working with partners to access that data to target and measure ad performance. I think, you know, you'll see us again, week 5, but, you know, looking at new technology solutions, like what's out there, what, you know, how can I continue to stay updated on technology developments and understand what measurement solutions are coming. I think those are some of the ways that we are, and me personally, are preparing for what's coming. I know we've had a big push internally to start looking at our first party data and how we can grow it. And I work at a company that is 160 years old and has a lot of legacy systems. So there's a lot of opportunity to go in and examine the data that we have. You know, so it's a good time because we're already in there doing that. But I think that's probably the biggest thing that we can do is just look within at what data we have. So I think those two things, right? Looking within and then assessing and embracing any whatever new technology solutions are out there or being developed.
Yeah, and I think I'll start more at the macro, Chris, and about like what we're seeing across the industry. The reality is some companies aren't doing anything about this because they don't feel the imminent change coming. Like some companies we talk to aren't thinking about this. And I think that's great for us if they're a competitor, because I think this is going to be such a big and sudden change that when people start rolling this out, it's going to be really difficult for some companies to catch up. And I think the big companies that have serious decisions to be made here, like Google, et cetera, they're looking at the philosophy behind what to do when it comes to targeting. Like they haven't even made the decision on this is our cookieless solution or our philosophy about a cookieless future. So I think those macro trends are moving target and something that we're all going to have to be ready for. In terms of our business, I think it's similar to Beth. It's a couple prongs. The first prong is my daughter has, I think we all remember this toy. It's like, it has different slots for different shapes that you have to put through them. So it's like you have a star shape, you drop the star shape thing through, you have a circle shape, drop a circle shape thing. Our business is a little bit different in that you guys would both represent, you know, your consumer's data or your client's data in the case of you, Kristen, and Beth's data. Like she'll be able to make a decision. We are using this solution. Our business works a little differently where we have to be amenable to either of those solutions that you guys would choose. So we're building our business in a way that has the sort of star slot to absorb best data and the circle slot to absorb Kristen's, your data or your client's data. So like we have to be nimble enough to ingest any of the future solutions that our partners will want to adopt. And I think that that's really hard with a moving target. It's something that we're balancing, rolling out things like Identity Link as a first step, or research in Google, or Ads Data Hub, ADH, clean rooms, and things like that. So I think the first one is being adaptable and ready to absorb anything that comes at us. The second one is re-architecting our solution. A lot of companies in this space have built this Jenga tower of performance and optimization, and the bottom layer is the cookie. And they're looking at it and they're thinking, okay, yeah, I know I'm gonna have to remove that. That's a tricky one. But if I pull that wrong Jenga block out, my optimization or my performance offering is going to tumble. And that's scary for a lot of companies. And it was scary for us. So we started doing the one benefit other than cool accents of working at a British owned company is GDPR came really early to them. So we were forced and faced with this problem really on. So when something like CCPA hit, it was like, oh, CCPA, that's GDPR light, we're ready to go. So like we had some of that architecting where we were able to build our performance and optimization stack on something other than the cookie and build almost like a Jenga tower beside the one we had built on the cookie. But if you look at even at the names of the projects from like the IAB, like it's Project Rearch, re-architecture. Every business is going to have to re-architecture the way that they think about targeting and performance moving forward, not just big tech, but agencies, media and programmatic providers, brands themselves. So that's the second part for us is re-architecture. And then the third one is really solving for the long term. Both open and closed web ecosystems will have privacy compliance solutions. So we're going to need to be in a position where we can work with Ads Data Hub, Trade Desk Identifier, clean rooms, any clean rooms from our DSP partners. And we're going to have to understand how to aggregate and provide meta analytics across that. So I think it's really the re-architecture, the ability to ingest anything, and the ability to interoperate with the big privacy compliant companies out there. That's where we're preparing.
Sorry, just to build on your, I think your point about GDPR is important. Because this probably a couple years ago, I remember having this conversation when that was coming out. Right. And people were like, oh, what is that? It doesn't have anything to do with me. We're not a European based business, but the fact is like, you needed to start having conversations, whether you were European based or not, you needed to start having the conversations then. Right. So you guys at MIQ are fortunate because you're a UK based company. But I do think that there's a miss if companies aren't even even talking about this, if it's not in their conversation now. It actually should have been in the conversation 2 years ago or 3 years ago, whenever GDPR was starting to come out. Because like you said, now it's starting to, you know, bleed into our states, and now with the future of a cookieless world, you know, it's something we should have been planning for several years at this point.
Definitely. I think if all of the participants take nothing else away, if you're not thinking about this, you should be. Absolutely. After this, set up a meeting with privacy, compliance, with whoever you need to in your business. But this is something that absolutely everybody should be prepping for, as Beth and Charlie have said. I could not agree more.
And there was a question in the chat really quick from Jim, just asking us, who do we think are the potential most at risk in the industry from the death of the cookie? It's a great question. I agree with you, first of all, that Google is a huge winner in this. They've built up their own ecosystem. They've built a privacy first solution. They are designing their own identifiers for Chrome. Awesome. I think that is big time for them. I would say companies that have built a large amount of their retargeting capabilities on the cookie, because that is, if I am working at one of those companies, I've got my engineering team focused solely on moving away from the cookie. I think you have to look at cookie aggregators, so people who aggregate data from various different sources, and that's the bottom layer of their Jenga tower. I'd say those two sectors in particular would worry me. So sorry, Kristen, maybe you were supposed to pick up on the questions from the chat.
No, this is a team effort.
I actually, and I agree with you, and I'm actually looking at Jim's question now, because I do think the big winners are gonna be Google, Facebook, because of their size and the size of their first party data, and Apple. I mean, companies that already, you know, I just think they have the means also to build new solutions and are building new solutions. So I think those are, I think they're just going to continue their stronghold on the digital ecosystem.
And then new entrants, it's like companies, a ad tech company comes out and says, we are a privacy first performance business. Those will be the names that are on these panels in the future to come up, for sure.
Yeah.
We have a couple other questions. So one question is, would brands, publishers, and platforms pay the consumer for their data?
Can I take this one, Beth, first?
You can. Go right ahead.
I love this question. For me, this was going to come up in what does the future look like? I think our identity, our online targetable identity, is potentially a currency for people in the future. If you look at tokenization and the things that are happening inside that world and how people are turning their lives a little bit online, I think, is it crazy to say, and this is like a thought experiment I do with my team sometimes, it's like, okay, if Xfinity comes to me and says, you can have your internet for free, so it's gonna save me $100 a month, but I'm going to sell all of your browsing data to advertisers to target you. Is that a fair value exchange? So I think if you think about how publishers and even ISP providers, what they know about us, personally, I don't know. But then what if you say Comcast is going to pay me $100 and I'm going to be their consumer because they can monetize me more than $100 a month? I'm interested in that. I'm interested in getting all the internet money I've ever paid back. That'd be great. But I think that will be a future conversation, is what is my identity worth to me? And how do I monetize that for myself? Which brands do I allow to speak to me? And I think like Ben Barakas has a company, SourcePoint, where you can opt in to different publishers, like what you want to see, your preferences and things like that. And I'm identifying the things that I'm interested in for the publisher. And then I think that we'll see more of that. We'll see more of consent, more of users realizing their value to be targeted. And I do think it'll be like users start to take, or consumers start to take more control of that. And I do love that thought experiment. If you think about it, like I'd be up for that. I would trade my internet bill for being targeted for every URL I go to, incognito or not. So.
Well, it's funny because one of the other questions on here, the next question in the chat is three parts, but the middle part is what are some disadvantages for the end, like the end consumer? Like, what am I going to miss out on? I actually think about that a lot. Like, I think about all the things I see that I didn't know I needed, right? That I'm being retargeted with, or I think about that all the time. Like, what am I going to miss out on from this cookie-less world, right? Yes, they'll have my, you know, some first party data, but I don't know that that's going to carry through the way a cookie has, following me around to get me to buy those boots from Zappos, perhaps the best example ever. I mean, how many things have I bought that have been retarded? You know, it's like, oh, forgot the shoes. Oh, damn, I'll buy the shoes, you know? And to Charlie's point, I'm not sure. I might sell my data. Like to be able to get those, those messages. So I think, you know, some disadvantages from a customer point of view is I'm not seeing the things that I am interested in, because I'm just getting, it's like watching TV, right? Where you're not specifically targeted. It's just another broad reaching message where I'm not getting a specific message.
Yeah, and another implication that could potentially, you know, be down the line is we talked a little bit about publishers and how they could potentially be affected. If their inventory is less valuable, we could see a lot of publishers moving more towards their content being behind paywalls, which would be another effect, potentially negative, if people are used to getting their free content, like you mentioned, like TV, if the advertising is not as valuable, publishers are going to have to figure out a different way to get their revenue. So,
yeah, I had actually written that thought down, that there'd be going to be more walled gardens, right? There's just, it's not going to be as easy to measure anything either anymore because of that.
Yeah, I think, well, I want to just go back to the three-part question, because I think there's two really interesting bits. The first one is, when we say cookie-less future, does that include first-party cookies? I think in the short term, no, but in the long term, yes. So I think in the short term, you're opting into consent through terms and conditions of a site like Facebook, and they're going to be able to track and use that as we go through. And I think that in the long term, people will wise up to that and choose platforms that offer different tracking solutions outside of the cookie. I think the second point, what Beth was getting at, is what do you lose in a cookie list from a consumer point of view? Customization. You will lose some customization. You might get customization around the content that you're reviewing, but then you're not going to get as much customization around everything else you had done on the web, because the VLOOKUP for you inside that targetable features and attributes list is going to just dissipate. So, and then if the cookie list feature, can customer give consent to record cookies, but there will be no such option. I think in the short term, that's kind of, for me, there are horses and cars on the road area. It's like, first of all, I think we'll see a cleaning up of asking for consent. It will be very clear, yes or no. It won't be like yes, and then maybe four pages later, you can click no if you want. I think there will be regulation and legislation about making sure that consent is clear. And in the future, I do think there will still be opt-in for some people who are always going to want to use the cookie to monetize the user. So I just want to make sure I answered that one in full.
And then we have another question. Broadly, what does this mean for the programmatic space?
Oof, yeah. I think we touched on this a little bit. Like, it's going to involve a serious amount of re-architecture. Everybody's product and engineering teams in the programmatic space is going to be busy this year. It's not going to be a lot. It's not going to be a huge year for releasing a ton of cool and new exciting features and like bells and whistles. It's going to be people redesigning their performance algorithms to be focused on something other than the cookie ID. And I think what you'll see is a lot more. And this is something we've kind of always done, is ingest large amounts of different data sets. It's like people are going to have to be more voracious for data that doesn't involve a cookie ID. So it could be weather data, sports data, who hit a home run this inning, what's on the radio in this market, is it CTV data? And the ingestion of all that data is going to be important, because the cookie is going to be something that you're less reliant on. So you're going to want to diversify the amount of data sources that you use to generate and ideate on how much each impression is worth on each bid. And for me, that means that like the engineering and the custom algorithms and the things that brands and companies like us are going to have to write are going to be more complex, because there's more attributes you have to consider. There's more data sources, more data processing. So I think the implications for programmatic are huge. And I do think there will be companies that get it wrong. So I think it'll be a really interesting time in the programmatic landscape.
All right, well, let's maybe, I know there's some more questions coming in. We will get to them. But we've already been talking about this a bit already. So let's just move right into, what does the future look like?
Well, I've mentioned it now several times, but there's going to be a greater reliance for sure on first party data for targeting and developing. If you don't have it, like figuring out how to develop your own first party data, or lean more into media partners that who can provide it. I think I mentioned this too, like I feel like more of these solutions are going, technological solutions are going to crop up from like major vendors like Google, Apple, Facebook, which is going to allow them, it's going to strengthen their control in the space. We talked about, you know, more walled gardens, but I think that's going to happen. I think a greater reliance on CRM, you know, from a company, if you don't have a CRM solution, that's going to be something you're going to need to develop so you can gather, you know, more first party data and be able to target using that CRM data.
Yeah, I like that. I'm down with that. I would add, like for me, it's sort of the three horizons. So horizon one is food on the table. Horizon two is food in the refrigerator. Horizon three is crops in the field. So horizon one, like what do we look at right now? I think it's a little bit like the regular cookie. Like it was a shock to all of us that eating chocolate chip cookies was not the best way to get in shape. Like it was an unhealthy thing, and like people sort of revolt around the cookie, and it evolved. It changed. Like now you can get protein cookies, you can get whole wheat cookies. I think you'll see like an evolution of the online cookie in a similar in a mindset. Like it could just be like a first party cookie or first party targetable information. I think the mixture, like I keep saying, of cookies and cookie list, as some companies make the transition and others don't, or some states like CCPA, great example earlier, Kristen, regulate the ability to use a cookie, but Arizona, I think, will be the second state. When will that happen? And that's what I meant by like the transition of cars and horses on the road. I think that's the horizon we're in now. And there's going to be cookie list solutions and privacy first solutions, and there's going to be cookie based solutions. And well, they're performing better than us because they're using the cookie, and we're not performing as well as them because they are using the cookie, and that's not the future. There's going to be a lot of that, I think, kind of in horizon one. That's the food on the table. I think horizon two is going to be a lot of privacy first solutions. It's going to be like a big investment in companies exploring things like Ads Data Hub. It's going to be a big investment of people looking for companies that are offering clean room solutions for anonymized measurement and ways to proliferate targeting in a compliant way. I think that's sort of horizon two. That's where a lot of our resource and energy is right now, because we feel good about horizon one. And then I think horizon three Who knows what the future of identity is? Are we all selling our data to Xfinity and they're paying us for free internet? Does everyone have free internet in exchange for targetable ads? You know, does Apple TV come free as long as Apple gets access to every show I watch and they want to monetize that? I don't know. But it's a really interesting question about what Horizon 3 looks like. So is it your identity as a currency, for example? And I think what you will see is aggregators. You'll see like people who want to plan cookie lists, people who want to buy cookie lists and like activate cookie in a cookie list manner, and people who want to aggregate and report clean room data and cookie list data for analysis and things like that. I do think that's a couple years down the road, just based on where the big tech companies are right now.
Got a couple questions that are directly related to points that both of you just spoke to. So somebody says, I read a headline today that said the rise of second party data. Either of you have any experience or thoughts you want to share on second party data?
Yes. Beth, you want me to take this one first?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, cool. So second party data is basically when you buy the data from the first party directly, and it's not like touch. So just as a point of clarification for those who didn't know that. I think, yeah, we do have a lot of experience with second party data. And I think second party data is important, and the ability to buy second party data is important. And I think it is correlated to cookies, because right now cookies are the way that we would use to find and target some of those people inside second party data segments. I think that is a good also delineation between the future of identity and the types of data. People are going to figure out a way to get second party data without using the cookie. Yeah, or maybe it's a different type of way of looking up, or maybe it feeds through a company like LiveRamp, it comes back in an identityless way. Or I know Ads Data Hub is working on ingestion of external data into ADH. If there's a way to ingest that second party data in and then formulate recommendations inside your Google stack because of that, that is on their roadmap. Those are things that are being worked on. So I think we do have experience with second party data. We do it all the time. We know that space really well. The interesting point about how it relates to this is, what is the communication mechanism between the seller of that data and the purchaser of that data? Right now, a lot of that is based on the cookie. So we just need to sort of break that fabric apart and reweave it in a more compliant way.
I personally, in the companies I've worked for, we've been very fortunate to have a ton of our own first party data. So I don't have a lot of experience with second party data, but I could see that becoming, you know, a bigger space to play in moving forward, for sure.
And then someone else asks, so the opposite of having a whole bunch of first party data, if you don't, someone says, I suspect brands will be interested in developing loyalty clubs or some form of that with a quid pro quo for consumers for data. Do you think that consumers will have an appetite given that they're likely to be asked to join many? How can brands make it compelling for people to hand over their info?
Yeah, I mean, I do think there'll probably be a little bit of consumer wear out from if that happens. Like I said, set up a CRM program, but I think, I think about the number of loyalty cards I have from stores. And I mean, it's not a behavior that is is new, right? So every time you go to, I don't know, Ace Hardware, DSW, Dick's Sporting Goods, you get a loyalty card from there. And this is no different. You're still registering for a loyalty program. Maybe I'm unusual, but every grocery store, Ralph's, Safeway, you know, you have loyalty cards from multiple places. This would be a similar thing, but I think you're also only going to register for things you're truly interested in.
I agree. And I think that's also the future of our identity. Like, is there going to be a way to have all of my loyalty cards associated to my user ID inside the Google ecosystem, and I control how much people get to see or not see?
Yeah.
And how targeted my web experience is because of that.
Yeah. You're taking, it's your data. You're taking it in control. So whether thousands and thousands of brands have them, it's you're the one that's signing up for it. So you're still controlling your own data. I do think that that's a very real possibility, that that's what, you know, will happen, is brands will start offering mega loyalty, you know, many, many loyalty programs, you know, to stay connected to their consumers.
I think the second part of that question is super interesting from Katie, and it's like, how can brands make it compelling to hand over their information? I think that goes back to your point, Kristen, about sort of consumer trust. It's like, if I trust you with my data, I'm more like, if I trust you with my secrets, I'm more likely to tell you more secrets. Yeah. And it's like, if I trust you with my dollars, I'm more likely to give you more of my dollars. And if I trust you with a little bit of my data and I opt in, how can you make that compelling? I think it's, what can you offer the user in terms of that? So let's say in Beth's shoe example, it sounds like you do your shoe shopping at DSW. I love that spot. It's where I buy all my kids' shoes. But let's say I'm on the DSW side and they say, hey, we would love your consent to speak to you more often. And as one of our loyal customers, we're going to give you a perpetual 10% discount card. And if we ever stop targeting you using this consent data that you're buying into, we will not offer you that discount anymore. I think it's like, can brands offer that value exchange when they look at LTV of a customer versus getting the consent to target and speak to them in an appropriate way? And I think that they will do that, but it'll be tricky without the cookie, and how that evolves is going to be really interesting.
Well, to your point, I mean, that is a lot with how the brand messages too, right? So what their communication message is, that's part of building trust, right? So it's, what does your brand believe in? How are you merchandising that to your consumer? And as a consumer, do I buy into that?
And then another question, definitely related to how we're adapting. Can companies capitalize on our data if they mask our identity and create some identity cohorts, even without the consent, either now or in the future?
Yes. This is a two-part question. Can companies capitalize on our data if they mask our identity? It depends on who you mean by companies. And they won't be able to capitalize on it as much as it's being capitalized upon now.
We already are capitalizing on your data. We hash it. Yeah.
And I think so. First of all, yes, but in less. And I think if you think about like the Ads Data Hub and how it's working, like they have three or four potential solutions on how they're going to resolve identity. And some of that does put you in cohorts of targetable audiences, or addressability is really what we're getting at here. Like, what's the addressability issue in a privacy compliant future? And I think, you know, companies like Google have multiple potential paths that they can go down to place you in cohorts for targetable. I think what Swasti Vikram was getting at was, if we have, in a cookieless environment, will we still be able to be targeted by our behaviors by companies? Yes. But will that be identifiable down to the individual level, or even to maybe like a group smaller than 10,000? I don't think so. So I think it'll just be limited, and it will be limited by sort of hiding in a crowd of fellow cohorts, if that makes sense. And I hope I got your name right. Sorry, I gave it a shot.
Right. Well, we are closing in on our time. So I will just see if either of you have any either parting thoughts or advice for people that for participants, if they want to get themselves educated, how they go about starting the process.
Yeah. I'll go first. Beth, you probably have better advice for brands and agencies because you've helped so many in times of transition, whether it was social or programmatic identity now. So I'll let you speak to that. I think from our point of view, what we're trying to do is keep our client base and our prospect base updated as things change. Like I said, Google hasn't landed on a solution yet. And the people that work with us know we know that, and know that we're like in an athletic position waiting for Google to make a call, and then we'll move with them. So like we're leading education sessions, unlock sessions. What is a cookie? How does it work? What are the identity? And you know, Joe will go over some of the bits on like after this on how to sign up and get more from us. And from our perspective, the more people that know about this, the better, because I think, like I said, this change is not just one particular company's problem. It's something we're all going to have to address together. So I would say educate yourselves, educate your legal and compliance teams, because things like CCPA, Arizona Privacy Act, GDPR, if you're an international brand, are going to be huge in the next 24 months. And that's sort of the timeline. I think we have to figure out all these issues.
Yeah. I mean, I would have said the same thing. I mean, honestly, educating yourself, attending things like this, I hope we were at least somewhat educational, but looking to your partners, as soon as you hear about anything, I mean, to Charlie's point, bring it up to your legal and compliance teams. Talk to the publishers you work with, see how they're preparing themselves. In this case, most of us are partners, if not all, with Google in some capacity. You know, I would ask them how they're, you know, what their plan is. I think education is probably the biggest thing. And Charlie, I think you said this about 20 minutes ago, but if you aren't talking about it, you need to be talking about it and planning for it. While it may not be like a one day we have cookies, the next day we don't, you still have to, now's the time to start planning for it and figuring out how you're gonna deal with it. Cause like I said, if you don't have a CRM program or you don't have the luxury of first party data, you're gonna have to start figuring out now how you are going to get to some of those programs.
Well, Beth, Charlie, thank you so much for sharing all of your knowledge and your crystal ball for what this space might look like in the future. We really appreciate your time. I'm sure all the participants were able to take multiple things away from what you shared. So thank you so much. And before we wrap on the topic of educating yourself, MIQ and SF Big have a partnership for some educational programs. So I'd love Joe to talk about that for a few minutes, and then we'll wrap up and cut everybody loose.
Hello, can you hear me okay? Perfect.
I just want to say this is one of the aforementioned British accents.
Thank you for the compliment on that, Charlie. First of all, just to echo what you said, Kristen, Beth, Charlie, thank you so much for taking part in this. This has been super useful. And Kristen, that was awesome. Thank you for moderating it too. I also want to thank everyone at SF Big. We've been working through this for the last couple of months. So Bessie, Kelly, Zach, Aidan, John, etc. Pleasure working with you in the build up to this session. So as Charlie mentioned and Kristen did also, we're super excited to announce what parts of our partnership are going to roll out in 2021 as we look to work even closer with SF Big. So the first part of that is we're committing to doing a quarterly webinar. And this will be around what Charlie talked about, which is our MIQ Unlocked content track. And a bit of background about that. That's essentially our educational initiative, where we're looking to work with our partners and clients to tackle some of the up-to-date topics that face us in our day-to-day roles within the industry. We've been working with agencies and advertisers to curate some of this content. And this cookie-less world one that we've kind of talked about today has by far been the most popular one in the last 12 months. So this was today's first session of that. But as we go into 2021, we're going to be doing one each quarter around a different topic. And that'll be with our involvement, with SF Big involvement, but also with other members where possible. Then the second part, which also super excited about, on the SF Big website, there's going to be a micro site where you and your businesses can sign up for us to come along and host some of these educational sessions in more of a personal one-to-one fashion. So we'll be hosting a content track on there, and not just the cookie list, but we've got topics like how to bridge the gap between TV and digital, also location-based targeting that have really been popular this year, as well as things like the reaction since COVID to consumer trends and behaviors as well. So the first part is there'll be quarterly sessions on top topics. And then as agencies and advertisers, you'll be able to sign up and request us to host these sessions at your businesses when suits you too. So all of that will be kicking off in 2021. Super excited for that to start. And again, just want to thank you, everyone on this panel and everyone at SF Big for helping organize today.
Great, thank you, Joe. And final plug, everybody make sure that you go vote and let your voice be heard. All right, everybody, thank you so much for joining and we'll see you next time. Thank you.
Thanks everyone. I love the panel, I love the comments.
Yeah, thank you a lot, really appreciate it.
Yeah.
Take care.